Praise the Lord. Saints, once again, we're back here at Kingdom Faith Ministry on a Friday night. Yes, sir, I said Friday. Hey, it ain't Sunday, but the word is good on a Friday. Monday, Tuesday is good any day. I got my bishop here, Bishop Larry Donald of Greater Trinity. We thank God for him. We just thank God for the fellowship that we have. We thank God for the Holy Spirit. Yes. We thank God for the Holy Writ. This scripture is inspired by God. Amen. And when we study scripture, I leave inspired. I always leave inspired because the word inspire, it inspires you. Nobody can sit who is saved and not hear the truth. Right. Whether it's cutting them, they inspired to change. And then if you don't, and you leave rejoicing. So you're going to be inspired one way or the other. Saints of God, we're talking about discipleship. And me and Bishop were discussing this. This is a kind of not a hard, I don't like to use the word hard, but a lot of people hadn't been taught this.
Right.
It ain't popular. Christianity is more popular than discipleship. Now, we said over in Acts 11 and 26 that the Antioch people noticed that these people behavior, mannerism, speech, lifestyle were not like them. Right. And they quickly deemed them as a derogatory term back then was Christian.
Uh-huh.
And I think it's derogatory now because everybody is a Christian now.
The way we use it.
And something you said, Bishop, and I'm going to let you talk about what you were saying about what God, you wrote some things down. I want to address this before we get into Matthew and talk about this. Talk about what you talked about earlier so we can set the stage for this tonight.
The first thing that the Holy Spirit just unctioned me with is that Christianity should look the same on every disciple or believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. So it shouldn't be one saved and they're living according to the scripture and another saved but they're living according to the world. Christianity looks the same. And what I mean is Christianity has to be in holiness.
Whoa, wait a minute now. You just jumped into denomination, man. We Baptists.
Holiness.
We First Self-Righteous down the street. We the Pentecostal. We this. So we Baptists, we don't believe in holiness. We saved anyhow. Once saved, always saved.
Well.
So now you're getting into denomination. That's what people would think.
Right.
Who really don't understand what you just said.
Right.
This ain't no denomination. Uh-huh. This is from our Lord and Savior.
Yes.
God is calling for us through scripture. He said, be ye holy, for I am holy.
Right.
Come out from among them.
Right.
Okay, go ahead.
And I think one of the things, too, as Christians being from the Christos to Christian to Christianity, our lifestyle must be the epitome of what Jesus lived.
Oh, so let me ask you something. When Jesus dealt with the common people, how was his attitude?
His attitude was good toward the common people. Jesus was 100% human, 100% divine, but he didn't think himself no more than anybody else. I mean, Jesus was in his human form showing us that you can be in the flesh but have a divine attitude and a mindset.
That's true, because he had it. And Paul told us, give way to this type of thinking. Let this mind. Okay, so he's calling for the ones who have accepted Jesus to renew their mind.
Right.
Okay, now if we don't renew our minds, we're going to think, well, God know my heart. It's greasy grace. And God had to help me with that insurance. He said, if you keep wrecking purposely, the insurance company going to drop you.
Right.
Because you're a risk.
Right.
Now, you saved by grace, and we look at that as insurance for our messing up. But what if you habitually wreck every day with your life?
Well.
What is that saying?
you are a risk to your salvation.
Every branch in me that bears not fruit,
he cut away.
Okay. Just like the branches are dropped, insurance are dropped, too, because you... You'll go ahead.
Right.
And
I think that the other thing was a Christian lifestyle should not resemble his lifestyle when he or she was a sinner unless he or she is still a sinner.
Okay, that's good. So attributes, the attributes of Christ, we call it Christianity, the attributes of being saved. Jesus loved the common people. He healed them. He was gentle with them. He dealt with them because they didn't know. The people, common people, were uneducated.
Right.
Only the ones had the Mosaic law and the scrolls and the 600 and some all other laws added to it was the priests, the Pharisees and scribes.
Right.
Now, he was different with those because they claimed to know.
Right.
Now, how do you treat a person who is humbly going after God versus somebody who claimed to have so many scriptures under their belt? They got all the revelation in the world, but they're not living nothing. And that's what Jesus, that's why he got on them Pharisees and scribes. He said, you look good on the outside.
Right.
But inwardly, you stink.
Right.
He just called them out. But why was his attitude different? Because he held them to a higher standard.
He held them.
They was leading the people. Why can't, Bishop, I hold you to a standard?
Right.
You holding me to a standard. Don't
Amen.
Have a problem with that.
Right.
I don't have a problem. When I first met you, I already knew what the deal was.
Yeah.
I'm like, hey, I can get with him because he already holding himself to a standard. But somebody ain't got no standard. They don't deal with you.
They
don't
really
want to deal with me.
They don't want to deal.
So Jesus held them to a higher standard. We men of God, you pastors, you need to hold yourself to a standard. You shouldn't say, I'm saved from
head to waist.
Head to waist.
From waist down.
I ain't gonna never. I'm saved all the way,
all
baby.
The way.
When I got born again, I ain't gonna sing that song. Looked at my feet, these still big old ugly feet. But I'm born again. My feet are shodded with the preparation of the gospel. How beautiful are my feet when I walk according to the scripture.
Yes.
They're not beautiful because I'm a preacher.
Right.
Because I can be a jackleg. I can be a novice. Go ahead.
Right. And you went to a very interesting word, an attribute. What was the attribute of Christ? Christ's attributes was the epitome of his Father. The Father was holy, so he was flesh. He was in the flesh. He was 100% fleshly, but he was holy. Even when Jesus got around people that were doing contrary to what the Word of God said, he still remained holy. He stayed there. And an attribute is a word describing a quality. So when I use the term Christian, I'm careful because if I don't see a Christian quality, I can't use that word.
If you don't see a lifestyle,
it's got to be a lifestyle.
And pointing to Christ.
Pointing to Christ.
Now, it's funny you said that because the Holy Spirit hit me with that very thing. Jesus was a man.
He was a man.
But his life, he had a life.
He had a life.
And he was God, but God knew. If he came down in his glory like he was, we couldn't get with it. So
with
he sent somebody in human form that we could identify and said, this is what my Father is like. Jesus, he epitomized his life to show us what our Heavenly Father
would look like,
and he demonstrated. So what I'm saying is, Bishop, Joe Nathan, Jeremy, and Reggie, our lifestyle has to line up with him because Jesus showed us what our Heavenly Father is like. So now we can't identify with God because he's a spirit. He's a Father, but he's a spirit. But we can identify with that human man, 100% man.
Yep.
100% flesh, but 100% anointed.
Uh-huh.
Submitted. So what you said earlier, and I'm going to say this, people don't think it's possible.
It's possible.
That's a lie. God said, him that believe, to them that believe, all things are possible.
Things.
You just don't believe it.
Yep.
And don't get mad when somebody is walking above. Look at them. I've heard this so much in my life. Look at them. They all, they holier than thou self. And I say, I'm holier than you.
Ooh.
Don't put me down because I love the Lord. I love.
Right.
I used to love the devil and everybody knew it.
Yep.
And everybody know now that this man is born again. I don't have to say it. They saying it among themselves. When you giving the attributes,
right?
People gonna know it, Bishop.
They gonna know it.
They gonna be uncomfortable around you.
Yep.
They ain't gonna wanna come in. Put that up. There you go. Don't do that. I tell them, don't cramp your style. Keep doing it. Because when I want to preach, I'm going to preach.
Amen.
Go ahead.
And so when I look at Jesus being 100% human and 100% divine, this is what he said. He said, I became that you could become.
Okay.
Okay. In other words, Jesus was saying, I became just like you all. I didn't come, I put my deity on hold. I took on human flesh, and I came and I walked among men. And I never did anything contrary to my divine nature. So the divine nature of God is in us. Once we get saved and get filled with the Holy Spirit, the divine nature of God is in us.
Okay.
So with the divine nature in us, there's a certain way we got to walk. Our lifestyle got to exemplify the holiness of God every day. It doesn't matter how much people persecute us. It doesn't matter how much people reject us. Our lifestyle has to still be the epitome of what Jesus became for us, that we can become the righteousness of God.
I agree with that, Bishop. So, you know, most people saying, well, I'm saved and God know my heart. And it just don't take all that. I'm saved. I ain't there yet. I'm in the process. But Jesus, the way he lived, and I was teaching this before some weeks ago. Jesus was born through a woman.
He was born through a woman.
So he had to put on, he came through Mary's womb to put on flesh.
Put on flesh.
He had to. Now, man didn't have nothing to do with this birth.
Right.
The Holy Spirit, Mary asked, how can I be pregnant not knowing a man?
Right.
Not being intimate with a man. And Gabriel broke it down for her.
Uh-huh.
She said, be it unto me according to you have spoken. After he broke it down. Now, Bishop, when I got born again, I was virgin born. Man had nothing to do with it. I was spiritually born again from above.
Okay.
I had, and to order to identify.
Yeah.
With Jesus' virgin birth, I had to be born again.
Okay.
Now, that God had, that's what I've been teaching. You remember I was teaching that. So, mom and daddy didn't come back, because Nicodemus is where I was going. Nicodemus said, wait a minute, can I go back into my, Jesus said, wait a minute, Nicodemus, aren't you a teacher? You a rabbi, man? And you don't know this?
Right.
Now, didn't he have the scriptures in Isaiah saying a virgin was going? That's why Jesus alluded to Nicodemus. You ought to know this.
You ought to know.
You ought to know. It's written of a child was going to be born.
Right, right. But Apostle, you said something earlier. You said when you was born again. People not being taught that they have to be born again. They're just not being taught this. This is just something they hear sporadically. And when you hear something sporadically, if you don't have a leader that can actually take the time to teach you so that you can understand being born again, because 90% of the people that hear that, they're just like Nicodemus.
True.
They want to know, can I go back at an old age and be reborn? That's not what he's talking about.
That's not what he's talking about.
And so leaders must take time. We done preached about cars and houses and all this stuff and crocodile shoes and all this. And we have not yet taught the people what it means to be born again. They just don't know. And when you start talking about being born again, they are in awe.
Okay. And now, Bishop, since you went there, so now that I'm born again, what happened to me? That old nature was eradicated. It was nailed to the cross of Christ. God, Jesus condemned my sin nature in the flesh by living the life and displaying the attribute.
Yep.
He had to fulfill the law in order for me to be righteous.
Right.
Now, he condemned sin in the flesh. My sins got condemned when Christ, as he lived an obedient life to the end. When he was raised from the dead, my sin nature, not even being born yet,
right,
was doomed, cursed. Now when I got born again, it got activated. Now I don't have to identify with the sinful nature. I get to identify with God. Now I got his nature in me, pulling me toward him, giving me unction to study, giving me unction to go toward holy things.
Right.
And cut away the ungodly thing, because everybody that I used to hang with, I cut them off. I cut them off, got them away from me, because I no longer had that taste in my mouth. I have a taste for God now. But when I had that other nature in me, Bishop, nobody had tell me to go do that. I had what was in me that was calling me. Now, we got it. Well, why ain't that nature calling us to the holy thing, to separate?
Wow.
Now, that's something to talk about.
You know, when you said that, Jesus rendered our sin nature helpless. It couldn't do anything. He took all the strength away from it. He rendered it helpless. But we will go back and give it help.
What you mean? Explain what you said. We would give it help or health and give it help or life.
Yeah, we would give it health and help. We will actually put it on life support. And we will let it breathe. And anything that's on life support, there's a possibility it can start living again. And so when we have our sin nature reserve on life support, what it's doing, it is gaining unseen strength because it's getting ready to live again. It's just like the man that created the monster. And when he got out of control, he didn't know how to kill him.
Frankenstein.
He created this monster. So when we create our sin nature all over again, because Jesus nailed it, but when we bring it back to life, we bring it. Wait, there's a part of us.
But you see, Bishop, all have sinned.
Huh?
And comes short of the glory.
But that's past his ED. You know.
Wait a minute. There's nothing righteous. I'm just telling you what they throw at you. This is what they say to combat.
Right.
The man on the gurney with the IV, the old man with the IV and all. Well, you know, God know my heart.
Yeah.
I'm in the process. How long you been saved, bro? You been there 30 years.
And in the process.
Just like that man at the pool of Bethesda. But Jesus asked him, do you want to walk? I ain't got no Jesus. Didn't ask him that.
He asked him,
did he want to walk? Go ahead.
But no, I'm just saying. See, we got to be very careful because in our divine nature, we have the ability to recreate.
No, don't go there.
Because we're in the image of God.
Don't you go there. What you teaching, that ain't milk. People don't want to hear that.
They want to hear it.
Who you think you are talking like that, but I know it to be true. After confession, salvation is brought about by confession.
Yep.
After I confess, everything is done through a verbal confession.
Yes, it is.
The world was created with word. God said, my word is upholding the universe.
Yep.
It upholding the word. Well, so now the word can't hold your little life up. It's holding up the universe, keeping gravity in place. But it can't do nothing for this thing. I'm in the process. I've been stuck here. Because you love it. That's why.
Right.
You love it. If you love God, you would walk out of that thing just like Larry got out. Loosen. Take them gray clothes off. We still got the gray clothes.
Yep.
I just got to get a smell of that aroma. I ain't forget. Get a little bit of that. So Jesus said, loosen. He ain't dead no more. Get him out of them grave clothes.
Right.
But the church come in with mourner stuff on.
Yeah.
When they tore the roof off, I'm going to let you get back, but we got to get in there. But what we're talking about is good. This is good. The four friends brought the man.
The paralytic.
Went through the door. All them Pharisees and scribes in there.
Couldn't get in.
Couldn't get in. The one who needed him couldn't get to him. They said, we got something. They went on top, tore the roof, and lowered him down.
Right in.
And the scripture said the presence of God was there. All of his power was there to heal. That man was the only somebody got healed. And he wasn't the only one in there messed up.
Right.
Now what do that tell you? All of the power and the presence of God is here on Sunday morning. Wherever you work, all the presence of God, all of his power, his holiness, everything is here. And people don't come. I wonder, God bless me. Like you said, we have allowed that prosperity gospel. I call it a prosperity gospel to a degree, because Bishop, when I got born again, I became a child of God. Mm-hmm. I was born into the family of God. I'm heirs with God, joint heirs.
Uh-huh.
And my inheritance is based on me enjoying it now while I mature.
Right.
Because I'm under tutors and governors until the appointed time. If I never grow up, I can't. God won't let me have. He won't release because he know I'll jack it up.
Right.
So I ain't worried about cars, houses, land. When you need, the provision going to be made.
His provision is there.
A workman is worthy of his hire.
Of his hire.
Okay, go ahead, Bishop. Now.
I mean, you've thrown so much out there. If we don't really.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry, man. But this is what we had, Bishop. We can. We are supposed to reduplicate. I'm reproducing when I disciple you.
Yeah.
Bishop, I'm gonna say this, and we're gonna get right over here and keep talking about what we're talking about. Cause this is lining up right here.
Okay.
All right. I'm gonna take Jeremy. I'm gonna use you for an example. I'm gonna take you. You ain't born again. You talk like you born again. Don't read nothing into this. I'm using your book. But I want you to disciple a man. I'm going to take you. I'm going to lead you just like you are. What should I expect these men to turn into?
Just do just what he do.
Okay. So Jeremy always late coming to church.
He going to always be late.
He tithes when it's good, when the sun's shining. But when it's hard, he don't give.
Okay.
So what the men going to do?
Same thing.
Why?
Because he's reproducing.
But why is it that when men get around men in the church and they see these men like that, tell them, I wouldn't give if I were you. Why would you allow them and nobody has assigned these people to you? Why are you hanging around? Women, why are you hanging around women who are teaching you to go against the past? I ain't going to say first lady because we're talking about past.
Yeah.
See, they're making disciples.
Right.
It ain't for God, though.
Right.
On God's territory.
Right.
No, bro, we can't. We, as men of God, we can't sit back worrying about, if I mess with them, they going to stop giving. Well, God said, I will. A workman is worthy of his eye. He said, what did he tell them? Take no purse, no script.
Nothing.
One guy, that script, one of them scripts is not a sermon. One preacher said that was a sermon. He said, see, don't even take a script. That was a bag. Search it out.
Right.
He said, see, no, they don't even take no sermon with you. I'm like, okay. All right. So, Bishop, now, saints, we want you to understand something. Everything we're talking about is biblical based.
Right.
And it's scripture sound. So, we're not off target here. So, a call to discipleship and not Christianity. Jesus didn't say, go ye and make Christians.
Nope.
He said, make disciples.
Make disciples. All right.
Well, here we go. Matthew 4th chapter, Bishop. We're going to start at the 18th, and we're going to read it all the way down, and we're going to skip through till we get to the Sermon on the Mount. Now, when God put these men in Jesus' path to become disciples, we're going to look. None of these men were scholars. None of them had been to the seminary. None of them had been there. These men were businessmen. Some of they had no formal training in scripture.
No.
All right.
Matthew chapter 4, verse 18. I'm reading from the Amplified. And as he was walking by the Sea of Galilee, he noticed two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, throwing a dragnet into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, come after me as disciples, letting me be your guide. Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men.
Okay.
At once they left their nets and became his disciples.
Mine said immediately.
Okay, immediately.
Then the earthquake come immediately.
Immediately.
And suddenly. We want immediately and suddenly, but from God, but I can't give God that immediately and suddenly.
Right.
You know, we go ahead. I'm sorry.
Sided with his party and followed him. And going on further from there, he noticed two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John.
Wait a minute. Notice, Bishop, I want to stop the first group of men that he saw, two brothers. Mm-hmm. You didn't see them arguing?
Right.
Fighting?
Right.
He saw two brothers had been trained by their daddy working together.
Together.
They had a work ethic.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Just wanted to point that out.
In the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets and putting them right, and he called them. At once they left the boat and their father and joined Jesus as disciples.
This is not a call to walk on water. This is not a call to lay hands. This is a call to be trained.
Trained.
Okay. But notice he found two more brothers.
Right.
Not arguing. Who caught the most fish? Who ain't doing nothing?
Right.
I'm going to tell Dad on you. I'm going to tell Mom. Wait till I get home. Wasn't no argument. What I see here, that he found a set of four brothers who had a work ethic and could get along with each
right.
other. Right. Wow. Okay. Come on.
Sided with his party and followed him. 23 says, and he went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the good news gospel of the kingdom.
Wait a minute. John came preaching the kingdom, preparing the people for to receive Christ.
Uh-huh.
Why did God give John, Bishop, the message about the kingdom? Then here come Jesus after he got out of the wilderness. We know the Holy Spirit led him there.
Uh-huh.
And he come out, now he's getting his ministry together.
Right.
What was he preaching?
John came preaching about the kingdom was at hand.
Okay.
So he could prepare the way that when Jesus came through, it wouldn't be the first time they heard. They heard the kingdom.
So we're not here. I didn't hear the kingdom until I saw it standing in the Bible. I ain't heard nothing about no kingdom.
Nope. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego.
Going to heaven. It ain't going to heaven. It's inheriting a kingdom.
Right. Right.
Come on.
And healing every disease.
Whoa. Wait a minute. Every disease?
Every. Not some. Every.
Okay. Well, there's some stuff out now and out back then.
Every.
That's what a novice would say. Every. I'm with you. Come on.
And every weakness and infirmity among the people.
Wait a minute, Bishop. Every weakness?
Every.
I'm just weak, but I can't help myself.
But not to cut you off. When I looked at this, he never prayed. He never laid hands. He only taught them. He taught them to do this about the kingdom and healing every disease and every weakness and every infirmity.
Now, Bishop, ain't it funny how these guys don't know nothing about this?
Don't know nothing.
But he had to demonstrate
Absolutely.
Some attributes of God.
Yep.
To seal that you ain't just following anybody.
Right.
After they saw this, I'm like, they like, whoa, who is this man here? Now, every person would have got the big head because they were chosen. But
right.
now, we're going to get down to the fifth chapter because he had to check them on the attitude because
uh-huh.
following a leader like that, following somebody like that,
uh-huh.
you get lifted up in pride.
Right.
All right, come on.
So the report of him spread throughout all Syria.
Whoa.
And they brought him all who were sick, those afflicted with various diseases and torments.
Let me ask you a question. I'm not being, some of you may watch this and think I'm being funny. Did he put a cover charge?
No.
Did he have to get people to sign up?
No.
For a registration fee?
Mm-mm. They just brought them.
He didn't charge nobody now?
Nobody.
Okay. All right.
Those under the power of demons and epileptics and paralyzed people, and he healed them. And great crowds joined and accompanied him about, coming from Galilee to Decapolis,
uh-huh.
in the district of the 10 cities east of the Sea of Galilee, and Jerusalem and Judea, and from the other, the east side of the Jordan.
All right, now these guys have seen the move of God through Jesus. Man, they have seen this, they saw the divine part of him, and they seen the man part. They done seen something.
Right.
There. All right. Now, we finna get into them. Now, he's talking particular to these guys that he got.
Right.
All right.
Right.
Let's go on in the Beatitude. Now, notice the first thing Jesus taught them. How to take up an offering? No. How to go out and witness? No. He's finna deal with what a disciple attitude
right.
is like, because he was letting them know what his attitude was.
Right.
So, Bishop, how much attitude from these scriptures right here, Matthew 5, have you noticed within ministry? I didn't say your ministry. I said within ministry.
Not very many.
Have you heard this taught on a frequent basis?
No.
Okay.
No.
All right. Come on.
No. Starting at 1?
Yes.
Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain.
Did he do this to escape the crowd?
No.
Okay, come on.
And when he was seated, his disciples came to him.
All right.
Then he opened his mouth and taught them, saying.
Stop. The title says Sermon on the Mount.
Uh-huh.
Okay. this is what got me. Everybody telling me when I first started preaching, you're going to hoop. You're going to hoop. Now, this is what God pointed out to me right here. This is the Sermon on the Mount. He said, look at this.
Okay.
And when the disciples were seated, he came and began to teach them.
Right.
So he didn't preach. He taught.
He taught.
But it's called a sermon. Can't you teach a sermon?
Right.
Okay. That's what I'm saying. But back then, in that dispensation, if you're not hooping and you ain't preaching, you're not giving
right.
a sermon.
Right. Right.
You're doing a speech. That's what they told me. Come
right.
on.
Blessed, happy, to be envied, and spiritually prosperous with life, joy, and satisfaction in God's favor and salvation.
Okay.
Regardless of their outward conditions, are the poor in spirit, the humble, who rate themselves insignificant, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
What is the first thing he pointed out to these men, Bishop, from right there what you just read?
First thing, you'll be happy. Then you're going to be envied. And you're going to be spiritually prosperous because, well, let me finish it. With life, joy, and satisfaction in God's favor and salvation because he taught them.
Okay.
He didn't scream at them. He taught them what he knew.
Okay.
What he had experienced.
Okay.
Okay, regardless of their outward condition, their inward condition was they was ignorant and unlearned. So
okay.
outwardly, they didn't value them as really knowing anything.
Okay, yeah, right. So, and after that, he said, blessed are the poor. He wasn't talking about you're blessed. And I think people have read into that. You know, to be a Christian, you can be saved, you got to be poor.
That's true.
Not what he was talking about.
No.
He was talking about being humble.
Humble?
Was he humble? Was that one of his attributes?
He was humble.
Can an arrogant person access, can God flow his power through somebody that's lifted up in pride?
No. Because you won't, he will, but he won't get the glory. Because God will not share his glory with another. An
okay.
arrogant person is not about God, it's about them.
He was addressing because they had seen Jesus heal all them sick people,
right.
weak people and all that.
Right.
But he was letting them know you must be humble.
Right.
If you're going to be my follower, you got to be humble. Is
right.
that an attribute that we see? Bishop, what I have seen, I've seen a lot of mean people.
Yeah.
In the body of Christ, when I first got saved, I've seen people arguing, fussing at the meetings, the church meetings. When I became a pastor, I stopped having them because I saw from me going to them and nobody could agree on anything. The trustees and the deacons were ganging up on the pastor, and it was just a bunch of stuff going on. I stopped going.
Yeah.
But when I became a pastor, I said, "What we're not going to have, we're not going to have any argument." It turned into that. I said, meeting adjourned.
Right.
And finally, God said, when are you going to catch a revelation and stop having it?
Yeah.
I stopped having
it. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Blessed are the poor in spirit.
Okay.
See, they forget that. Blessed are the poor in spirit.
Okay.
In other words, people that are poor in spirit, it doesn't matter how God used them, they still consider themselves insignificant, because if God doesn't do it, it won't happen.
Bishop, and so many get confused like they doing something.
Right.
I know this person, you said, don't touch me. No, get back. Don't bump into me. Don't touch me. But Jesus said, who touched me?
Right.
Peter said, all these folks, who thronged me? You talking about who thronged you? Power left me.
Right.
This just wasn't no any touch.
Right.
Now, ain't it funny how people can touch? We have not an high priest that cannot be touched with the feeling and our prayers. He's sympathetic with our snotting and crying, but it ain't drawing nothing out of it.
Right.
That woman with this your blood, when she touched the hem, poor something. He
something
said, power left me.
Yep.
Virtue left me.
Yep.
And so humility is something, because I know if I had been in this group seeing what this man just did with these sick folks, I'm like, wow. And I can see into why he's telling them you must remain humble, because it wasn't him that's doing it.
Right.
It was what's in him.
Right.
So, Bishop, we got to remain humble if God is going to use us.
Right.
We got to remain humble. And he repeated it. Let's get the next one.
Blessed and enviable happy with a happiness produced by the experience of God's favor and especially conditioned by the revelation of his matchless grace are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted.
Wow. So in two, he said, blessed are the meek, blessed are the poor. Have you read both of them, or you have them in between?
Uh-uh.
That's on the next one, ain't it? Blessed are, what are we mourning from?
Wait a minute. Five is blessed are the meek.
Okay, you ain't got down yet.
That's
all
right, the next
but
one coming
what
up.
Are we mourning about, Bishop?
I have no idea what we mourning about.
When we, the saints who are truly born again, mourn for injustice, mourn, we're crying out to God because not because of things ain't just right in our life. He said our outward condition,
right.
We got to remain faithful to God regardless of what our outward condition, because when things are not right in the church lives and we looking out and we crying out to God. What did he say right there?
That's what he said. Regardless of their outward condition, or the poor in spirit, the humble who rate themselves insignificant, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
The kingdom belong is not kingdom of heaven. It's a kingdom.
Right.
It's going to come back down
it's
to earth.
Come back down.
But why we keep talking about going to heaven, and me and Jeremy were talking about this earlier before you came, every song that I remember singing pointed to heaven way on down the road.
Uh-huh.
Now, I ain't got to live heavenly now. Jesus lived heaven. He showed us what heaven
right.
was like and what the Father was like with his life
right.
on earth.
Right.
But nope, everybody talking about if I had wings, I'd fly away. When the gates swing open, it's always talking about heaven and experiencing eternal life later on as the pie in the sky. But what about living heavenly now? What about now? We put that way off. No, I'm eternally saved now.
Right.
I have eternal life now. My quality of life should be heavenly now.
Right.
Because I got some attitude that if I implement this,
right,
I can experience the kingdom right now.
Right.
Go ahead.
So how will we know how to live in heaven in the future if we're not living heavenly now?
Let my will be done
on earth
as it is in heaven.
In heaven.
Bishop, as you were talking right there, and I'm going to go back. When Jesus called these guys, he picked them. What was you doing when you were called? that's what he hit me. He just hit me. He said, they were called. This is a call to
right.
discipleship.
Right.
Being saved, coming up in front of the church. That's not a call to join Greenwood Pentecostal Church.
Right.
That's a call to discipleship.
Right.
He's calling you. What were you doing when God called you?
What I loved.
Oh, wait a minute.
Because these brothers here were doing what they loved.
Whoa.
Let's be real now.
Okay.
See,
all right.
I didn't try to get myself ready for the call.
Really?
I was doing what I loved.
So Bishop, what we have heard, well, when I get ready, you'll never get
it. You ain't going to never get it.
You ain't going to never get ready because you love what you're doing.
Absolutely.
And they was in the midst of what they love and what they were thriving with.
Yep.
And he called them out of it.
So I had to be honest with you. I was doing what I love. And it wasn't churchy.
I was doing what I love.
It had nothing to do with a Christian life.
Okay. All right. Okay. All right.
Because, we got to remember now, if you're going to get yourself together, you have nothing to examine yourself by. I knew who I was.
You weren't in denial about that.
Oh, I wasn't in denial.
Okay.
I was like Paul. I was the chief of them. I had a little club when I was
Okay. So God ain't looking for squeaky clean people.
Nope.
Peter, the first one, that joker cuss you out and cut you at the same time.
Chopped a man ear off.
But God knew.
He knew.
He knew what was in Peter.
Apostle, if I can interject something.
Yes, sir.
when God called you, he'll call you in a messed up state because he has invested. If you can be taught the holy word of God, that's an investment. A lot of people want to inherit money. I want to inherit the things of the kingdom.
Amen.
The teaching of the holy word, the lifestyle that Jesus lived. If you study the holy word, you'll learn how Jesus lived, and then you'll learn how to live.
I noticed that you said study.
You study.
We got 10 minutes. Nobody's preaching. Not a lot of people are preaching. I know I've preached this ever since I became a pastor. I taught discipleship. I taught the kingdom. I taught studying the life of Christ.
Right.
I just recently told everybody to go back and read the four gospels and notice what Jesus did. Look at his life. Man, look, check out how he handled people, how he dealt with people,
right,
how he dealt with the Pharisees. To really get them to examine his life.
Uh-huh.
That's our life. He demonstrated on commercials. I see them demonstrating Genovac, that generator. They showing what it
right
do, why it's got to serve. They advertising this car or truck, how much load capacity
right
it can handle and pull, the power of it. They demonstrating it by hooking up a heavy weight to it, showing you the power that this truck is capable of doing.
Right.
Jesus demonstrated what we now possess.
It absolutely
ain't work well in his hand.
Right.
But it ain't working when the church got. Why is it short circuiting now and it wasn't short circuiting with Jesus? Same anointing.
Had been taught.
True. So I ain't been trained on, I think they need to do a class on a cell phone, because I bought more phone than I can handle. I got to upgrade if they had it. I think when people get called into this, they're getting an upgrade of life and can't function it.
Right.
Because they, first of all, may have a leader who don't want to teach them to upgrade, may feel threatened when these people go to study because he may not have the time, may not take time to study.
Okay.
So he feels threatened. I'm not threatened. I want you to study. I want you to come with the question because it's going to keep me sharp. Please study. I want you to study.
Pastor, can I say something?
Yes, sir.
This is going to sound funny, but this is going to hit tight right in what the pastor said. I went last month and bought a set of earbuds because everything else was hurting my ear.
Yeah.
I got the thing, went home. I just saw open the box and it'll automatically connect.
Okay.
I opened the box, the thing automatically connect. So one morning I got up, it wouldn't connect.
Oh.
First thing I said, I paid $247 for the earbuds and they won't even come on. So I was sitting there, and the Holy Spirit said, read. I'm like, read? I opened the box. The instructions was hidden. I read. You have to open the thing and hit the little button in the middle and pair it. So I had to study the instruction to know what to do. So if we're going to live like Jesus, you got to study the instructions to know what to do.
Okay.
Now, you said something, and we don't catch it. You said when they demonstrated this truck, they hooked behind it to see show you how much it will haul. When you study Jesus' life and you hook up with him, you better look and see how much you got to haul. You got to haul persecution. You got to haul being envied. You got to haul people being jealous of you. They're going to have malice. They're going to have strife. They're going to do everything because you got to pull a load.
Okay, that we ain't got there yet, but in the scripture, Jesus said, picking up your cross.
That's what he said.
Denying yourself, number one, picking up your cross, and follow
me.
You're going to have to deny everything that's going on with you. It's happening, but you got to deny you. Not denying that it's happening, but knowing when you following somebody, your eyes are on him.
Wow.
So you're not really focusing on the abuse. You're focusing on the one
him
you're fixated on.
Right.
Because that cross is helping you bear. Really, the cross ain't a burden. It's really helping me to bear the ridicule.
Absolutely.
Because it keeps me in remembrance of the insults.
Absolutely.
That was hurled at him.
Yep.
Father,
yep,
forgive them. Yep. They know not what they do.
Yep.
He didn't fight back. He could have.
He could have, but he didn't. We'll fight.
So, Bishop, this is good right here, because Jesus now it began to teach these men
right
on what it is about this call into discipleship. He didn't call them in and just follow me. Now, do what I just did.
Right.
No, he taught.
He taught them.
He taught. And he gave them tests along the way.
Right.
And go ahead. Let's get one more. Come on.
Let me say this. If you look at the Beatitude, he was teaching them, this is how your attitude got to be.
True.
It can't be anything other than this. You got to be the first partaker of this before you can ever do anything I did.
But I'm anointed. You know, I don't care what that say. And he jealous of me because he won't let me do it. But you got an attitude.
Right.
Your attitude ain't like right in here. So why would I let you do it?
Mm.
Your attitude ain't right.
Right.
I had a brother come here one time. He met me at the car. I don't even know him. Somebody, he came over here because he came from a larger ministry and came here. And, you know, it was years ago. This man, this was back in the early 2000s. He met me at the car. Let me get that. Bro. I don't know you. Do I look like I'm bored or carrying a book bag? My briefcase, I carried a briefcase back then.
Wow.
No, bro, I got that. Well, I want to be your armor bearer. I don't know you.
Wow.
Told him I don't know you. And I knew his spirit because he reminded me of a familiar spirit, that a brother that used to be here. So when I scoped in, I said, I know that spirit. I said, nah, bro.
Yeah.
I want a minister. I was a minister where I came from. I said, I don't know you. I said, I tell you what, it's a broom closet right around that corner. I said, what you can do, get that broom and that dustpan, go in there and sweep them bathrooms out, sweep that foyer, and go get the mop bucket back there and mop them, and we'll talk.
Did he do it?
No. Come back and ask me to preach again. His attitude wasn't right. I couldn't let him get up and poison.
Right.
You can't let everybody up speaking because they can hurt. All that you have been ministering years, one Sunday can ruin years.
Can ruin it.
Because they just hoping what you ain't been talking ain't true. Because it irritates me. I ain't doing all this. You know, I'm serious.
Yes.
But we got 5 minutes, Bishop.
Okay.
So learning to emulate does teach us life. That's what Jesus.
Right.
So we emulated. You said you were the chief. I was first, close, second. And the day I got saved, hell stopped. They wouldn't bother nobody. They said, we done lost a trooper.
Yep.
Why can't we get him back? Hell stopped the day I got born again because I was no longer following that evil lifestyle.
Right.
Something happened to me. My eyes came open.
Yep.
And I saw the world for what it is. Bishop, to be converted and to be called into discipleship, that's an honor to me. And it humbled me to know that God could really use me as messed up as I was. A guy told me today, he said, man, you got a symbol of hate on you. I got a swastika that I put on. I was studying this in history class, world history. And we were studying about the Nazis and everything. And I put a swastika. He said, man, you got a symbol of hate on you, but you a loving brother. He said, God didn't tell you to move? I said, no, God ain't told me to move nothing. I'm saved from the inside out, not outside in.
Yeah.
And he said, you a loving man walking around with a symbol of hate. I said, how do you do that? If I didn't have love in me, but this swastika, Polynesian, a girl I ran into years ago, I was in the mall, Metro Center, matter of fact, I was walking. She was standing outside because there wasn't no business in the store. She said, hey, come here. What are you doing with that on your arm? I said, what do you know about that? She said, that's how I worship him.
Wow.
Yeah. It has more than just Hitler meaning.
Right.
I said, oh, okay. I know that, but I didn't know. She said, well, what do you got on? I said, I was just marking. I was under the influence when I put that over it. But I'm under the influence of the Holy Ghost now. But you know what I'm saying, Bishop? We must emulate our teacher. And I emulated Satan. Now, I can emulate with Jesus. And he gave them power.
He gave them power.
Now, wait a minute, bitch. Ain't it funny how what he taught them to do? And we're going to get in. We're going to be on this a while. So we see how he gave them that anointing, and they went out and got results.
Right.
And they came back rejoicing.
Right.
They didn't do it.
Right. He did it.
He did it through them.
Yeah.
But he was giving them a taste.
Right.
If we study this stuff, we ought to say, why ain't this happening with us?
Because we confess the anointing, but we don't have any teaching.
Okay. Now, And that's true. It could be true. A person is in the body of Christ, truly saved, is anointed.
Uh-huh.
But they got to be trained.
Now,
am I humble enough? Is my attitude right to be trained? Can I allow Bishop Donald, Larry Donald, to teach me? Well, he lied, and he be pointing at me. And that Daniel fella, he just loud and crazy. I can't learn nothing from them. Somebody told me that. I can't learn from them. I said, you Jackson State fan. Ain't that band loud in the stadium?
Sure is.
You go there?
Yep.
I just can't receive from you. No, you have no honor for me. You need
right.
to go find you another church.
Absolutely.
Amen. So, Bishop, in closing, the believer put the responsibility of getting people born again on the clergy and ministry.
Right.
And, and
it's going to be everybody.
If we teach you, then you
do.
Sheep begets sheep.
Yep.
Sheep don't give, the pastor don't give birth to sheep.
Yep.
And I won't say that, I'll say that the next time. But, Bishop, in the clothing, what do you give us something to go back over what you said in the beginning, some of the things, attributes, and
Christianity should look the same on every disciple or believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. I put emphasis on that. A Christian lifestyle should not resemble his lifestyle when he or she was a sinner unless he or she is still a sinner.
Okay. Now, is that after the first couple of months, a year, or they've been in it 15 years and still?
Apostle. She making it tough.
Because some people would think because they first got saved, they've been in a month, 2 months. You know, a baby
right.
got to learn how to walk.
Right.
There's a grace period
right.
for that.
Right, right.
But what kind of grace period is there for somebody to say they stuck in the process and been in a teaching ministry for 15 years and still on goo goo gaga, got an apron on, got a rattler, and a pacifier stuck in their mouth?
That's.
What is that?
I don't want to use that word.
Okay, you don't have to, but go ahead. I'm gonna finish saying.
I'm just about done because if we now that we have got into being a Christian, now somewhere down the line we got to go back because the disciples in the 21st century have no clue what the Beatitudes entail. They've given their own interpretation. Bless are the poor in spirit. They think that means to be poor.
Yeah.
But when I looked at that, I cannot think that the spirit that is in me is of my own doing.
True.
It has to be given back to the giver of the spirit who becomes God himself living in us. They don't understand this. And so now we're trying to teach a people what the anointing is, and they don't even understand the Beatitude.
That's true. So, Jesus reiterate the sacrifice that they have to be willing to make
right.
to give up everything
right.
to be a part of God's kingdom.
Right.
You can't serve two masters.
Right.
You can't be in the kingdom of darkness and enjoy the kingdom of light.
Right.
You can't. If you in darkness, then Satan has got you in bondage.
He got you in bondage.
He don't want us coming into the enlightenment of disciples. Nobody taught me, Bishop. I had to study. I hadn't heard discipleship taught in church.
It just was, when I came through, that wasn't even heard of.
No, it wasn't, but we in it now because the Holy Spirit wanted to be taught, and we're not refuting or trying thinking we know everything, but,
right.
but I'm just being led by God on this platform to teach discipleship.
Right.
And it's a call to discipleship. We call in ministry. We're called to be a prophet. We're called to be evangelist. We're called all those gifts, speaking gifts. But when it comes to following,
we're not called.
Nobody called for that. The ministry of helps is an anointed ministry.
Right.
I never got to hear anybody in my time of pastoring, I've been called to the ministry of helps.
They don't talk. They didn't talk
That's
about
anointing.
That. Yep. They didn't talk about that.
So. Bishop, I appreciate I was blessed tonight. We're going to get back into these Beatitudes. Y'all want to get ahead of them? Go ahead on and study. We got a few scriptures, Luke 9:23-25, Luke 14:25-26, John 8:31-32, Matthew 28:16-20. Uh-huh. Yeah, Jesus said, go ye and make disciples. He didn't say make Christians.
Right.
Teaching them. I ain't taught. How can I teach them to observe?
Right.
How could I teach y'all to observe something when I won't obey Jerry?
Right.
I live to convict you. I want you to be convicted. Jonathan, I'm living purposely so you may see something in my life, Reggie, that it makes you mad, makes you not want to be around me. But at the same time, you questioning, I got to get where he at.
Right, right.
That's what God told me to live to convict.
Right.
And it's time for us to do that. People go, and from that, what Bishop said, you're going to be hated. You're going to be persecuted.
Yep.
And you need to count up the cost because you ain't going to be popular following Jesus.
Nope.
And I'm just confused why all this popularity come about. Amen. With that, Bishop, thank God for you tonight. This is Bishop Larry Donald, Greater Trinity. Go check him out. His service time at 11 o'clock. What's your address?
750 Bolden.
750 Bolden, 1036 South McRaven Road, Kingdom Faith Ministries. And the reason why our ministry is named Kingdom Faith, because we're using the faith from the kingdom that was given. Yeah, well, I teach kingdom. That name kingdom ain't there for just the sound. Somebody said, well, y'all kingdom hall? No, we are the kingdom. I ain't never heard that. A white gentleman pulled up out there and wanted to argue with me. I was out there cleaning the sound. I was planting flour. He pulled up. Well, you know what you teaching ain't right. I said, it ain't right for your church. You don't even know nothing about this ministry, bro. Now, if you want to learn, but you ain't finna tell me. You stopping while I'm out here in the sun planting flowers. And you want to combat with me on scripture by telling me I'm going to hell? Well, okay. I said, well, you have a good day. I was drinking water. And he kept trying to talk. I walked on into church.
Wow.
Locked the door. He's steady arguing. Amen. I done learned to don't argue with people. In my younger days, I was full of it.
Ooh,
I wanted to prove you wrong. God said, that ain't your argument no more. We'll be right back.